could perhaps one day go back to my studies, gain some more qualifications, and maybe even become a nurse or an occupational therapist. The one-time dream of becoming a vet or a doctor had died, along with the confidence that I was capable of such advanced study. Away from the reassurance and support of my school and family, my ambitions for higher learning had fizzled and faded. I smoked rollies and gave up over and over. The smoking didn't seem to affect my fitness, but I liked the taste and smell of food better when I was smoke-free. The only good reason to give up came from the patients who had lingering diseases caused by their habit. Many of them urged me to stop, and I could for months on end, but I missed the calming ritual of a smoke with a drink and the collegiality of a shared cigarette break with other support staff. Sometimes I wondered if the habit represented a link to my mother, who had stopped and started over and over after Anahira died. 24. A Lesson for Handholders, Auckland. Professor Robbie looked around the auditorium, waiting for the latecomers and chatterers to fall silent so he could begin his presentation. Prof looked so old he might have learned his anatomy centuries ago, when crowds flocked to watch surgeons open the wicked and display their hidden parts to curious crowds. The hospital lecture theatre was whitewashed with light and individual tip-down writing desks, places to plug in laptops, and a raft of audio-visual modcons. I was the only member of the hospital support staff who came to the lunchtime program, open to all but attended mostly by health sciences students, physiotherapists, medical students and retired GPs. I perched on one of the lower rungs of the hierarchy that defined this place. In the hospital's rigid pecking order, one needed, at a glance, to know who was the cleverest, who to defer to, who could be safely spoken over. I disguised my uniform with a dark polar fleece top when I came here, so I didn't feel so out of place.